So why don't we get started? Welcome to the second lecture of CVSB 203. I just want to remind you that this second lecture is not of the kind that you saw last week. It's not intended to be a core lecture on the texts, but is what we are calling an enrichment lecture to provide you with the contexts in which these texts were written. So to give you a background and other dimensions. And this particular lecture is going to be presented by Dr. Jihad Touma. And let me tell you just a little bit about him. He's professor of physics here at AUB. He got his PhD from MIT. He has published papers on the demonstration of the chaotic rotation of the state of the chaotic rotation state of Mars with relation to its climate. Papers on the formation and evolution of the Earth-Moon system. An explanation of the high orbital eccentricity of exoplanetary systems, if I can read my own writing, it's difficult, on the dynamic rotation of fluid interiors and the mantle of the Earth and Venus, explanations of the double nucleus of the Andromeda galaxy, and he is now working on a theory of relaxation, which sounds interesting, a theory of relaxation of stellar clusters around supermassive black holes. And today he's going to talk to you a little bit about the Copernican Revolution. So please join me in giving him your attention.
I thank my colleagues in CVSB for playing this practical joke on me. Obviously, I don't have any credentials to be doing this today. I mean, you heard the introduction. I am involved in drawing the consequences of the Copernican Revolution for modern-day astrophysics. However, I did have some youthful interest in the historical underpinnings of our tools, our favorite tools, and in responding to their very kind and humorous request, I decided to dig into some of this stuff. So I went back to my library and I pulled out books that I had gone through some 20, 30 years ago. So I want to thank them for this occasion, and I hope that it opens up the opportunities for engaging as faculty and students around this engrossing subject of the history of science and astronomy in particular. I should like to add that AUB had had its share of contributions to that field. A number of its faculty members in the 60s and 70s engaged in fundamental work that led to a re-examination of what was taken for granted when it came to Arab Islamic contributions to the tradition. So, the subject is to do with the Copernican Revolution. In dealing with that subject, one has many trails to follow. Okay? This is a gentle public reminder. Okay, so one has many trails to follow. One can take a very broad point of view and try to contextualize Copernicus's work in the relationship to astronomy-related observation model-making around the world at the time. Of course, it wasn't particularly centered around Europe, but something happened around Europe that somehow did not latch on in other places, okay, in the same energy or vigor. Okay, so one can do that. I want to take a point of view where, okay, I will take that moment to be singular, and then I will examine it closely with you to the point that it actually loses some of its singularity and reveals some of the processes that were at work around the time. That will be my point of view. Okay, and the way I would like to proceed about it is a mixture of things. I don't know how we'll succeed. We have 50 minutes after all. We'll do our best. It's my first trial at this sort of exercise. And in case we need some additional time, I may ask the guys to schedule an extra session to go through the rest of the material. I find that enjoyable, particularly in late evenings. It will be my way of paying you guys back. Okay, so the singular moment we're talking about, a moment that a number of scholars, students of the period, students of astronomy, students of the history of sciences, generally educated the public, associate with the beginning of the scientific revolution is associated with the publication of the work of Copernicus, De Revolutionibus. Okay, that book was published thanks to the effort of an apprentice of Copernicus who carried it with him to a location where the press was already quite active. The publication took place around a time which was a very active time in the history of the world. In addition to the discovery of a new continent, one also was dealing with press and publication at an unprecedented rate. One also was dealing with exposure to material that was filtering to the European world through intensive translation exercises associated with connections to other parts of the world, coupling to Europe through Spain, Italy, and eventually the Ottoman Empire. So this is the moment we're interested in, and that moment ushered a series of transitions. Okay, may not have been directly responsible for them, but certainly it was the element, the foundation, the basis around which these transitions took place. Okay, so one of the transition is from the world of Ptolemy, which is associated with a work that you may have you gone through an Arabic education system as Al-Majast. Okay, this is how I learned about it as a kid. And so this is supposed to provide us with the basis of astronomy. Okay, and astronomy as an observational science, as well as an exercise in model building. Model building, and the key word for this model building is kinematic. Okay, from a physical point of view, this is a very important notion. It is kinematic, it is descriptive. It is profoundly mathematical, nonetheless, in the sense that it deals with the description of motion. Hence, it has to do with the theory of curves and how you would generate them. So one is concerned with building models to generate observed curves. Okay, that is the starting point of all of this work. And Ptolemy had a whole tradition of mathematicians on whom to draw. Okay, that had set the stage for the beautiful work that he engaged with as an astronomer. Ptolemy was working also within the Aristotelian tradition, and that is sort of the cosmological foundation for his work. After all, you need some basis for going after certain models or others. Okay, you need a basis for that. And the basis provided for Ptolemy resides in the ideas propounded by Aristotle and his followers. Namely, ideas that distinguish the state of rest of the Earth as the most perfect state, and circular motion, motion associated with spheres and circles, as somehow ideal. And motion on these circles is meant to be uniform. Okay? So you have to imagine yourself that the world for these guys, as far as the skies are concerned, the skies have properties that terrestrial world does not have, which is a form of idealism. That world is some sort of merry-go-round that is going around at a uniform speed. Now, yeah, in order to make sense of observation, you will need merry-go-rounds upon merry-go-rounds. That's the story that Ptolemy is associated with. Epicycles upon epicycles upon epicycles. And if you get dizzy, well, you're not alone, okay? So a number of people who tried to go through these works felt that same dizziness. Hopefully we'll have the time to bring it alive to you guys. So within that world, the world is, in some sense, okay, figured out, right? The question is a question of technique. We have to figure out how to do it better and better. You get better observations. You notice difficulties with this theory. Okay, the theory is rich enough to provide you with ways to correct things. It's a sort of tinkering workshop, okay? You face a problem, we'll have the solution, okay? Just need to put in enough effort. Okay, the transition brought about by Copernicus's work is layered upon this background, a background which was thoroughly familiar to Copernicus, as modern scholarship has shown, a background which involves profound contributions by many an Arab, Iranian, Ottoman, astronomer, mathematician. And the work of these creative people who faced serious difficulties in relationship to Ptolemy's work, their work, we now know, to a great extent that Copernicus must have been familiar with them in one form or the other. Okay, so that's one tradition, one transition. And so that transition, as far as we're concerned, brought about a shift from what we would like to call a geocentric worldview, okay, which is a view of the world that is the most natural one in some sense. It is the view of the world that you would have if you decide to stay late night with a camera that is put on a time-lapse mode, taking pictures periodically, and then you string these pictures together and you get a sense that the sky is somehow rotating. Okay, now we know that the Earth is rotating in one direction and the sky is relative to the observer moving in the opposite direction. But that point of view, that geocentric point of view, is a perfectly realistic point of view for an Earth-bound observer. And that point of view is one that motivated, again, the notion of circular motion as somehow fundamental to what is taking place. I'll have more to say about that later, assuming there is a later. Okay, so we shifted from a geocentric point of view in which an Earth-bound observer, very meticulous, very technically minded, and familiar with the philosophical underpinnings of the structure of the world as we know it, okay, took these ideas very seriously and went about trying to build models for how things operate according to these prescriptions. Okay, this is not something trivial. Okay, I think it must have been a tremendous feat for these guys to be doing this work. They went with it very far, far to the point that they could actually make predictions. And this is exactly where they were distinguished, in some sense, from their predecessors. The accuracy of their predictions in fulfilling, of course, important functions. Social functions, technical functions. We need calendars, okay? We need timekeeping, okay? Also, we need astrological predictions, right? So, within that world, a lot of things worked. And the work of Copernicus prepared the ground for a variety of reasons, hopefully I'll get to touch upon them, okay, for a transition from a geocentric worldview to what we now call a heliocentric, okay, model of how the world works. Now, what I would like to point out from the beginning is that Copernicus's contribution is no less a model than Ptolemy's contribution was. So they both function essentially as models. And they're both fundamentally kinematic models, okay? However, I do believe, and in some sense, there isn't a lot going for Copernicus in comparison to Ptolemy. And this is not my point of view, okay? This is, by now, a fairly common point of view. But for some reason, and this is one reason I kept thinking about as I prepared for this lecture, for some reason, something about the picture that is provided by Copernicus and the way he talks about it somehow impresses upon a modern scientific mind already questions that are germane to the scientific enterprise. Okay, something about that. But technically speaking, they're as complicated a series of models as we've come across in the earlier astronomical investigations by Ptolemy and his followers. Okay, so we went from a world in which the Earth is fixed at a center with things moving in a fashion that we try to understand based on careful observations, to a world in which the Sun is at the center and the Earth is moving, both rotating on itself and moving around the Sun along with the rest of the planets. Okay, so that's the second transition associated with this moment. Okay. A transition that is equally important is the kind of models that we build for ourselves, okay? Scale models, toy models, models that help enshrine the ideas associated with a given tradition. And so if I were to leave you with two distinctive models of the two traditions, I will leave you with, on the left, a drawing of an armillary, okay, which is a device that encodes the essential astronomical frames of reference or planes of reference, okay, that any observer would be extremely familiar with as they look at the sky at a certain period of time. Okay, you guys, I don't know how much you actually get to look at the sky, okay? I believe you have somebody else doing it for you, a piece of software, if you're interested. Are there any amateur astronomers between you? Hey, Aded Mushajia. Akidi Mushajia. Yes. Okay, so yes, I will talk about that immediately. So these guys were very concerned with the skies, and they had the opportunity to actually look at them. Okay, they didn't have buildings, they didn't have pollution to the extent that we have it, didn't have light pollution, okay? And they actually needed to look at the skies. Right now, you might have a phone which is certainly much smarter than this one, and you can navigate with it practically anywhere, including the skies, okay? This is extremely unfortunate, in my opinion, particularly when it comes to actually appreciating the subject, but for even deeper, for actually being motivated to engage in the study of the subject at all, okay? On the Copernican end, and after a year, هيدا طفينا عملنا شيء مخيف برافو. Okay, هلا كيف بدنا نرجع? Should I press it back? Yeah, it appears to be reversible. Okay, so on the right, what we have is a model that encodes for you, for rich people of the time, okay, the results of mathematical models of the world that build on Copernican worldview, but use the latest development in celestial mechanics, as built on the works of Newton himself, okay? So these will be, in this case, what you're seeing is the sun, planets and their satellites as known, and detailed models of the Earth as well as an Earth-Moon system, okay? This is what you see. And these encode, again, the results of detailed calculations of the time. Now, one fundamental consequence that I can't stop myself from pointing out is precisely of this transition and the work that followed, hundreds of years of work that followed, is the degree to which the skies are alienated from everyday life. Okay, this is very profound. To the point that the skies, on average that is, become either the mainstay of highly technical people, like myself, okay, or astrologers, which in a context like Lebanon, I would consider as my main competitors for public attention, okay? So astrologers, even astrologers, are no longer looking at the skies, okay? They probably simply run a software that tells them something is something somewhere, and based on that, they have their conclusions. For the Ptolemaic and Copernican traditions, the skies were profoundly present, and observations of the skies are what determined, finally, fueled much of the change that took place from Ptolemy to Copernicus and from Copernicus onward. All right. I thought that before I get into further details, that I would actually situate you within the sky, okay? Okay, I'm doing you a favor, okay? So if you go out and the sky is not as overcast as it is right now, if you go out and you look south and southwest, okay, between tonight, you will see. So how does this point? The third one. The third one. Okay. All right. So if you look south and southwest, I did actually take note of Venus a couple of days back. Okay, you'll actually note Mars, a reddish point-like object. And you can easily locate them in relationship to a crescent moon, okay? That's something you can immediately benefit from in relationship to this lecture. You go out and follow these objects over the next few days. This is a very important exercise. Now, what guys would have done is they would have structured, okay, an observatory which allowed them to come back and revisit these locations repeatedly over an extended period of time to follow the motion of a planet, in this case Mars, against the sky, okay? Now, if you actually decide to stay If you actually decide to stay overnight, the night is clear, and you have a camera on, and you're taking snapshots every few seconds, okay, of the sky, looking somewhat north, okay, Ras Beirut doesn't provide great opportunities, but you can move away from that, a journey of an hour and a half, and you can take a picture of the sky looking north, up and north, and you'll be able, eventually, to put together a time lapse, okay, of what has unfolded in your field of view overnight, okay? Now, when you take that time lapse, this is a series of photographs, okay, superposed on top of each other, you get this beautiful pattern, all right? And that beautiful pattern is a fundamental pattern for building any astronomical theory for what is going on, because it presents you with the beautiful regularity of a circle. This is as beautiful a circle as you're gonna get from the sky, okay? And that series of circles is associated with what the ancients talked about as the motion of the spheres associated with the stars, okay? So the stars have this perfectly regular motion, and it is associated with this circular motion, and there is this beautiful center to that circular motion, which is associated, as we know right now, with Polaris, or the northern pole of celestial sphere, okay? For us right now, this is close to the location where the axis of rotation of the Earth would pierce the celestial sphere. So this is a place that is unmoving as far as these early observers are concerned. Now, without the benefit of this extended observation, you will have great difficulty actually promoting, okay, notions of circular motion, uniform motion around a given center, a distinguished center, as a basis for thought and further investigation. All right. Now, if you were dedicated and had spent the last couple of years looking at the Mars, okay, you're following Mars against the sky in the last couple of years. Okay, so what do you expect, right? It's a planet, right? So you would expect to start out with that it would behave anyway differently from, say, one of the stars that we saw here. At least there should be some track of a circular nature that we can begin to relate to, okay? That's what you would start by hoping for. Well, nothing of the sort happens. Okay. In fact, Mars goes through what is thought of as a retrograde. Okay. So at some point, Mars appears to be moving forward in time, and then for an Earth-bound observer, it appears to be moving backward in time. Now, you may say, what does forward and backward mean? Forward and backward means in relationship to a fixed position in the sky, which you associate with one stellar constellation or a group of stars that you know how to recognize and you can relate that location to, okay? So, this retrograde motion presented serious problems for early observers, okay? Right? We want to be able to account for things in terms of uniform circular motion. What is uniform and circular about this type of motion? This is another indication at another time, okay? 2014 in this case, this is 2016, and they're likely to occur at your location every 2 years, which is associated with the orbital period of Mars, okay? So this is another indication of what that retrograde looks like. You can notice differences in shape, and what the early observers noted as well is not only differences in shape, but differences in the duration that Mars takes in going around one retrograde. So, we're noticing that things don't look particularly circular, then we're noticing that things are not particularly uniform. Now, note that what is at stake in these conclusions is nothing different from what we do nowadays. We look at things carefully, we identify a pattern, and based on the pattern, we can begin developing models for how things work. Now, the notion of models for us are very different, but the starting point is not that different, actually, okay? So, we have these retrogrades, which play a very important role for astrologers, by the way. Yani, if anybody knows about retrogrades here, it's probably due to astrology. Okay. This is what it would look like, okay, if you were come to actually perform this observation repeatedly around the same time and the same location of the sky. This is what the retrograde would look like. Okay, you'll be tracking Mars against the sky, and if you draw actually the points over which you tracked it, you'll end up with this beautiful curve. Okay, so Ptolemy, okay, was faced with this challenge, and the objective was to actually build models for how this should, something's supposed to work. Okay, so Ptolemy's main, one of the main objectives he had in mind is how to explain these features. I mean, they're noteworthy features. If your model can't explain them, you're in trouble. Okay, so the idea here, okay, in a Ptolemaic worldview, okay, is to imagine a circle associated, let's say, with a central location that is moving around the Earth at uniform speed. Okay, so one imagine first a first circle, that circle. This is known as the deferent. And the circle has a radius, which is set by size of the Earth in relationship to the planet. So it has that radius, okay? And we just shifted to the heliocentric point of view. So I should just backtrack a bit. Okay, so here is our deferent. And on top of that, there is another circle, okay, which is known as the epicycle, okay? So this is Mars, as far as the theory is concerned. It moves on this circle and then on the epicycle. And the motion on the epicycle, I have to backtrack, okay? The motion on the epicycle allows the planet to appear to be going backward with respect to an Earth-bound observer. So the center of the epicycle is moving on a circle at uniform speed initially, and then the motion on the epicycle is again uniform and brings about an apparent retrograde motion of the planet, which is here. Now follow it. Okay, we'll come here, and then it will go through a retrograde stage. Now we move to the heliocentric point of view. In the heliocentric point of view, we are again associated with some sort of epicyclic motion, but now the planet is moving around the sun. The outer planet is also moving around the sun. They're moving at different rates, okay? And with respect to an Earth-bound observer, the Earth-Mars line appears to draw this retrograde curve every 2 years, okay, around conjunction, around the time where they meet. Okay, so that also became very clear to Copernicus, and that provided, okay, a sense that there is an alternative point of view with which one can make sense of fundamental features of what is happening in the sky. Okay, so the transition I am talking about ultimately is associated with this figure. This is a rendition of Ptolemy, much later, artist rendition of Ptolemy. Okay, and he worked around 100 to 170 AD. Okay, and his book, which is a very technical book, encoding the latest developments in mathematics and astronomical science of his time, okay, provides what I'd like to think of as a kinematic model within Aristotelian cosmology. Okay, so it provides a model for how things work within Aristotelian cosmology. There is a gap here, and that gap, there is a lot to be said about that gap. Okay, I'll come back to that. The central point of our discussion has to do with the publications of Copernicus' investigation. And these investigations, if we were to summarize again their main contribution, ultimately they provide a kinematic model to restore uniform circular motion. Okay? Finally, Copernicus was not as radical as you may think. Okay? He was somewhat pissed off with some of the tricks that Ptolemy had to appeal to in order to explain, okay, some observed features. Okay, this non-uniformity I was talking about led Ptolemy to consider non-uniform types of motions, which is associated with eccentrics rather than pure circles, as Aristotelians would have expected. So in that sense, there is some Pythagorean bent to Copernicus, which is apparent in his writing. Okay, I'm not putting these words in his mouth. He actually was annoyed with the state of things as he read about them. Nonetheless, he provided a kinematic model whose attempt is to restore that uniform and circular motion. The other key transition, which this work somehow contributed to, very complex somehow, there is a lot of detail behind this somehow, no direct route between Copernicus and Newton, So somehow, the publication of this work contributed to a stage in which now one is no longer simply concerned with observations and kinematic models for what is taking place, but rather one is concerned with laws of nature. Okay? One is concerned with laws of nature in dialogue with observations mediated by the language of nature, as understood then and we continue to celebrate in the present, mathematics. Okay? So this is how I'd like to put it. One is now after the laws of nature, which in dialogue with observation allow us to create refinements, mathematical models that we can then hope to bring back to observations, explain, refine our models, and perhaps drive things to a point where the laws of nature that we have taken for granted themselves undergo significant, perhaps revolutionary change. Okay? So, let me say a few words about this particular gap. After all, we have some 1,200, 1,300 years separating these two guys, okay? Right? Now, any time you see a reading or a telling of a story which seems to jump, right, dramatically in time between a period and another, focusing on the singular figures of these periods, you should be suspicious, okay? You should be thoroughly suspicious about any attempt at history making that proceeds in this fashion. Okay, and the state of discussion was not very different from that for hundreds of years in some sense. Okay, even though Copernicus himself is clear in acknowledging some contributions from previous astronomers working about various schools associated with the Arab Muslim world in one form or the other. Okay, so Copernicus acknowledges that. So this gap in the last 40 years has been the subject of great and fundamental scholarship. And if I were interested in history, historiography, cultural history, history of transmission of knowledge, I would find in that period a tremendous opportunity for fun, learning, and perhaps room for contributions. Okay, so that period experienced a fundamental re-examination in ways that have highlighted, one, the importance of fundamental theorems already discovered by Arab astronomers like Al-Tusi and Ibn al-Shatir, two fundamental mathematical theorems, which they had come up with in order to address difficulties with the Ptolemaic system, in relationship partly to their idea of Aristotelian cosmology. Again, they thought perhaps that Ptolemy had departed from Aristotle, So they wanted to restore circularity and uniformity, but even more importantly, they found significant errors between the predictions of Ptolemy and actual observations, particularly when it comes to the latitude of planets on the sky. Okay, so far I've presented things to you as if they were all in a plane. Okay, there is an off-plane aspect to the astronomical observations which is critical. Okay, so these guys, Al-Tusi, Ibn al-Shatir, came up with these fundamental contributions, and scholarship has pretty much secured the conclusion that Copernicus was somehow familiar with these results. And to somebody like Owen Gingrich, an astronomer who spent a lifetime digging into the work of Copernicus, it is pretty clear that there is no de revolutionibus without these two theorems. Okay? Pretty much the technical work is an elaboration of the consequences of these theorems in one way or the other. Okay, albeit in a heliocentric perspective, but the complexities remain. Okay? Okay, in case I run out of time, and I'm sure I already ran out of time, this is my tradition, to run out of time. Okay? Okay, I will leave you with these trails. Okay? These trails have provided me with much joy, entertainment, edification. Okay? Particular among them is the work of Thomas Kuhn, who is also responsible for introducing one of the most profound models of scientific revolutions. Okay? His book on the structures of scientific revolutions is probably one of the most read books on the subject. Okay? So his book on the Copernican revolution is truly great, great fun. Okay? And I will coordinate with my colleagues the possibility of sharing some of it with you on your website. Then there is the sort of technical work, okay, by Swerdlow and Neugebauer. Okay? Neugebauer is also responsible for a monumental treatise on the ancient astronomy, okay, the mathematics of ancient astronomy. Okay, and his work has definitely revolutionized the way we think about the work of astronomers prior to Copernicus, what Copernicus actually owes to them, what Copernicus actually contributed, and whether it's all that is really cut out to be. Okay, and then there is another work associated with my friend and colleague Georges Saliba, okay, which has to do with Islamic science and the making of the European Renaissance. Okay, and I think you will learn a lot going through that book. If I were to choose one among the three, I will choose this one, because it provides you with an overview that is somewhat more congenial, okay, than the two that precede it. Okay? Now, in the time remaining, I would like to go over the actual texts, either by Copernicus himself or what was said about the work, and comment on these. Okay? So here is Copernicus actually talking about his predecessors. Okay? So he's saying, "I began to be annoyed that the philosophers had discovered no sure scheme for the movements of the machinery of the world." Okay? So one has to ask about what is his idea of certainty, okay? What is his idea about certainty in this context? Okay? "Created for our sake by the best and most systematic artist of all." Okay? "Therefore, I began to consider the mobility of the earth, and even though the idea seemed absurd," okay? So it wasn't particularly natural to him, though we should keep in mind that he wasn't the first to actually consider a model or a system in which the earth was in motion. In fact, even heliocentric systems were considered far, far before his time. Okay? But they didn't have the same consequences for reasons that perhaps have something to do with the way, the times, of course, surely the times, but also the way the whole subject was apprehended. And I'll come to that shortly. Okay? "And even though the idea seemed absurd, nevertheless, I knew that others before me had been granted the freedom." Okay, this is a very important notion. And to me, here I see Copernicus at play. Okay? غير عمله وما كان عنده سبب ليش أنا لا يعني. Okay? شو المشكلة يعني؟ I like that attitude. And I can vouch that we as scientists working in the present often have that attitude towards work that are presented to us as somewhat final, okay, having closed the subject. Okay? So I like that. Okay? I relate to Copernicus in that mode. And for me, this is sufficient. I don't even need to have any more fundamental reason to consider this. Okay? Just the freedom to consider it. Why not? What the heck? Okay? Let's consider it and see what we come up with. I like that attitude. Okay? Now, historians may have cribs with that. Okay? But scientists are rarely either concerned with the history that preceded them, the ancient history, or are aware of the historical portent of the work that they are doing. Okay? In any case, I knew that others before me had been granted the freedom to imagine any circles whatsoever. Okay? So it's like saying, okay, these circles, what were their motivation anyway? Okay? For explaining the heavenly phenomena. So why don't I allow myself that freedom? Okay? This is my positive look at what Copernicus has written. Okay, now we look at what others have written, others far more implicated in the subject than I ever was or ever expect to be. Okay, so I picked a few key statements for you guys from my readings. This is Kuhn in his text on the Copernican Revolution. So that the significance of the revolutionibus lies then less in what it says itself than in what it caused others to say. Okay, and the transition from what it says to what it caused others to say is a rather complex one. Okay. Nonetheless, it's an important observation. The book gave rise to a revolution that it had scarcely enunciated. Okay, it's like Machasni Shavev, okay? You want to revolutionize, go ahead. I'm just, perhaps, from my point of view, having fun. I'm having freedom, okay? So it gave rise to a revolution that it has scarcely enunciated. It is a revolution-making rather than a revolutionary text. Okay? This is Kuhn's point of view, and he elaborates that point of view beautifully, okay? Somewhat limited by the stage of scholarship at the time that he wrote the book, okay, around the 50s, okay? Much transpired after that, and a serious reconsideration of statements in that book are overdue, okay? Here is Owen Gingerich, whose writings on Copernicus, some popular and quite enjoyable, you might find particularly entertaining to go through. Here is what he has to say. But furthermore, if we turn once more to an analysis made possible by modern computers, and if we examine the old ephemerides, okay, we are shocked. So ephemerides are a sort of tables that provide you with locations of key celestial objects at around the year. Okay, so think of it as a table. We are shocked to discover that there is relatively little difference in the average errors before and after Copernicus. His work has scarcely improved the predictions. Okay, if you read some cursory account of what happened, invariably, you run around somebody who will say it definitely improved things with much less complexity. Okay? No, it's not the case. All right? These guys took a model, took the best account of observations, took the best account of Ptolemaic ephemerides at the time, and they examined them with computer simulations, and they reached that conclusion. Now, if you doubt it, feel free to engage with the exercise yourself to the extent that your skills allow. Here is what Saliba has to say, okay? And that's related to that gap I mentioned, okay? The real Copernican indebtedness to the Maraga astronomers, okay, so this is a school of astronomy, not only lies in the fact that he uses these same theorems, these are the theorems that I refer to build his own models, but that he also uses them at the identical points in the models where they were used earlier by the Maraga astronomers. Okay? يعني علاقات وثيقة. The question is whether it was possible for Copernicus to know of these two theorems, and if so, through which channels. Okay? And much scholarship has gone into actually one giving what to my humble conclusion. Okay, and a non-expert conclusion is a positive answer. Okay, he was aware of these theorems. Okay. All evidence points to that as far as I'm concerned. Now, the processes of transmissions have also been examined, and Saliba's work will point you to the relevant literature. Okay, so here we have it, right? Here is my polemical score sheet on the text, okay? That is supposed to be the harbinger of the revolution, perhaps the singular moment associated with that revolution. Yani, it must have done something so dramatic, how could we not have had a revolution? I don't buy that, okay? I don't buy that. Okay, so obviously there is no dramatic improvement in accuracy, Okay? If you look in the details, and I had animations to show you to actually point out the details, but that is for some evening, perhaps. No dramatic reduction in complexity. Okay? No dramatic reduction in complexity whatsoever. Yeah, and you have people saying, Ptolemy was building circles upon circles upon circles. Okay, it looked like really some circus juggling exercise. Okay, with rings upon rings being juggled by the astronomer and his somewhat faithful followers. Now, this is not the case. Ptolemy was doing a reasonable job with what he had, and Copernicus had to deal with equally complex juggling exercising in order to make his heliocentric model work. Okay? So let's be clear about that. Okay, hardly original in its core mathematical devices. Okay, I've tried to indicate that. I'm not expert on the subject, okay, please. Okay, so I'm quoting people who I believe are very serious and whose work I respect and that I've read over the years. Okay, so it's hardly original in its core mathematical devices. Okay, rather conservative in its insistence on uniform circular motion. Okay. Sahih, okay, he wants circles to be around the sun, but he still wants circles. The guy is stuck on circles. Okay? Around the center that displaces the Earth, but the center nonetheless. Okay? So again, he did not venture to revolutionize his vision of the whole cosmos. He simply said, okay, guys, I'm going to play a game. I'm going to move the Earth from its vantage point, okay? Put it on the orbit that will be associated with that vantage point. Okay, having assumed that the sun is fixed. So I reverse the role of the sun and the earth. Okay? I reverse the role of the sun and the earth. And I had I had my animations, I would have showed you that explicitly. Okay. Now, whereas Ptolemaic tradition, and this to me is fundamental, whereas Ptolemaic tradition remained faithful to the limitations of earthbound observers. I respect a theory like that. Okay? It has its faults, it's limited by its observational point of view, but I expect theory making of this quality, okay? So, whereas Ptolemaic tradition remained faithful to the limitations of earthbound observers, Copernicus had no cosmological foundation for his moving Earth. Okay, the Earth is moving, okay? And what is the basis for considering that? What is your basis for actually arguing based on earthbound experiments that the Earth is actually moving? This was the question that was raised to him by very serious people around the time, okay? Tycho Brahe being one of them, okay? One of history's most famous observers, right? What is the experiment that you can conduct on Earth that gives you independent evidence, right, for the motion of the Earth? This is not an easy question. Do you have any ideas? What experiment on Earth would you conduct to conclude that the Earth is rotating? Rotating on itself, for a start. Any ideas? Yes? Ah, okay. Tides are rather complex, and they were a part of what Galileo had considered as a foundation for concluding that. But they're not the most immediate, okay? And getting at tides in relationship to rotation is somewhat demanding. Any other idea? Seasons. Oh, people were able to account for seasons within a geocentric model without any problem. No problem. The sun is taking care of that. No. Okay, so you need a physical argument, and the physical argument had to wait, okay, for actually theories that can conclude something based on the rotation that is actually verifiable for an earthbound observer. We still don't have the vantage point of external observation, right? Okay, this is truly fundamental. And this is a fault, okay, a physical fault with Copernicus's work. Okay, some people have tried to describe it as more realistic, okay, than the Ptolemaic tradition. On the contrary, it looks like actually a step back in terms of realism. Okay, so let me conclude, all right? Let me conclude with what I consider to be most beautiful and inspiring in Copernicus's work, which is captured in this truly marvelous statement of his. Okay, so here he says, in this arrangement, therefore, the arrangement of a heliocentric system of planets going on circular orbits or near circular orbits around the central star, Sun. We discover a marvelous commensurability of the universe and an established harmonious linkage between the motion of the spheres and their size, such as can be found in no other way. All right? In this statement, okay, there are a number of things, okay, that appeal to a modern scientist. One, the notion of harmonious linkages. Okay, so he was able to identify a pattern which relates the sizes of the orbits in relationship to the time taken to go around the orbit. Okay, that had not been accessible to people working within that Ptolemaic tradition, because the Earth timescale had pretty much controlled the scale over which they do their work. Okay, so there is a pattern here. Thus, we perceive why the direct and retrograde arcs appear greater in Jupiter and in Saturn and smaller than in Mars. He's beginning to draw, okay, relationships between different retrogrades and has explanatory power, okay, for what is going on. And why this reversal in direction appears more frequently in Saturn, etc. All these phenomena proceed from the same cause, which is the Earth's motion. Okay, so here are the two terms that I would like to leave you with, okay, that are still in some sense the basis for our reflection as physicists using mathematics to deal with observable patterns with an attempt to reproduce them, explain them, provide predictions, provide falsifiable predictions for our theories, is the notion of established harmonious linkage and a cause. Okay, so we have a pattern, okay, a pattern which is somewhat encapsulated in a beautiful image in which the Sun, okay, is at the center and the planets are on circular trajectories, covering their circles with periods that seem to increase with their distance away from the central body. And we have a first attempt or indication of being interested in the cause, okay, cause for that pattern. Now, Kepler, after Copernicus, would take that very seriously. Kepler was very concerned with causes, okay? And Galileo was profoundly concerned with causes and mathematics as the language of nature. But the laws of nature take their most beautiful, okay, form with the work of Newton, okay, ushering for us hundreds of years of elaborate development of the consequences, okay, of the scientific revolution as somehow coupled to the work that I just reviewed with you. I will stop here, okay? I will stop here. I don't know if we have time for questions, okay? But I'll be happy to entertain questions here, over email, any medium that you find appropriate. Thank you.